Where we finished before lunch was, we saw the result of what a subgroup of the CI group of CI, respective digraphs, quotient is of the CI group is a CI group with respect to digraphs and graphs. And so if you come up with one counterexample, it's not a CI graph, you've eliminated a class of graphs. And what I'd like to do is sort of give you the summary result of all of that. I need to give you a definition. I'm sort of going to go through it very quickly because I don't really care right now. And if I were you, I would also not care. I put the definition there just so that for future reference, if you want to go back and look at what were those groups, you're not going to go have to look for the paper. But all of the groups that don't have common names are defined here. They're basically natural generalizations of, say, dihedral groups, natural generalizations of the non-abelian group of order 3p, stuff like that, in a relatively natural way. And I just did I mentioned the dihedral group, that's what this n equals 2. The non-abelian group of order 3p comes into it there. There's a particular group of order 4 goes with that, etc. And then you just sort of generalize these where we don't know what's going on. So most of this next result is a combination of the result of Lee, Lu, and Palfik from 2007, and then together with the result of Gabo-Sama from 2011. So GDSCI with respect to graphs. The graphs here is important. This actually is a theorem about graphs. The theorem for digraphs is different. The list is shorter because, well, we know that Z9 is a CI group with respect to graphs but not digraphs. So here, let me just sort of pump the whole thing out. You can see down here, these are the ones of order 9 that one has to worry about, that have an element of order 9. Here are listed the elements, the groups that have elements of order 8. The rest don't have elements. They have elements of order odd order, or order 2 or order 4. They can be written as a direct product, and then you just choose from the various lists. With abelian groups, basically everything has to be, every CELO subgroup has to be elementary, abelian, etc. Personally, I've never really thought about this list too much. I don't know why. I suspect that it is way too long. In particular, why am I circling these guys? That's because they have a Z9, which is a CI group with respect to graphs, but not to digraphs. And my feeling is that if you cross that with something appropriate, then maybe you can come up with a counterexample. Yes, there have to be some elements of order, CI groups with elements of order 9, but maybe you can't do too much, get too far away from the Z9 itself and do that. So, like I said, research-wise, I haven't really thought too much about this theorem, but I was thinking about it as I was preparing these slides, and I suspect that the list here is just way too long, that this can be narrowed down quite a bit. If you were interested in narrowing it down, I haven't written a slide about this, but there's a corresponding theorem for digraphs, and the differences between the two lists is where I would look for examples that are not CI groups. So here's the big list. Ideally, we'd like a theorem that would, we'd like a list where we knew that if it was on the list, the only possible, we'd like to know all the CI groups, I guess, is what I'm getting at. This list right now is just too long for us to have a real hope of getting such a theorem. I haven't gone through this individually, but again, this is the kind of theorem that, you know, even if I go through it, if you ask me this evening what's on the list, I'm going to go, I can tell you some of the groups, but not all the groups. So for me, this is not a theorem I would remember. It's there for reference. And if you need to look for a group, look. And if you don't, then don't. So there's the big list. There's also another big list. Which of these groups are CI groups with respect to graphs? And the graphs here is important. There's another slightly different list for slightly shorter list for digraphs. Again, this is not something that I'm going to really want to dwell on. You notice I spat out the first one. This is the cyclic groups we've talked about. That result, that's definitely something that you're going to want to pay attention to. There's the prime ZP to the K dihedral group. That's a very nice result. Bye-bye. The non-abelian group of order 3P turns out to be CI with respect to graphs, but it's not CI with respect to digraphs. D6P. The only reason I'm going to pause on this one is you should notice the date there. It's 2015. So if you're thinking maybe I'd like to work on some of these problems, are there still some small groups left that might be doable, but nobody's bothered to look at them yet? The answer might be yes. I'm sort of embarrassed to say that I haven't checked. This list versus the other list in grotesque detail. In general, what you're not going to want to do, though, is just sort of pick a group and try to see if it's CI. In some sense, you're going to want to have a reason for looking at the group. And the reason with all of this, P here is a prime. And if you look on the previous list, these groups are going to be on there, but there's going to be like an N there with arbitrarily many different prime divisors. So in reality, people are interested in the group, the smallest example, because if the smallest example doesn't work, you get to wipe out the entire class. So it's definitely worth looking to see about the smallest one. But then if you want to look at, say, D6PQ, that becomes much less interesting in and of itself. And if you went D6PQR, then people are going to start to think, okay, you know. In other words, do the small ones. If that doesn't work, try to do the arbitrarily many as opposed to just picking groups. That's what would be interesting. I don't have the date here. This one is also interesting because the date is 2007. Well, that's a nice thing. 2009, 2015. So there's been a flurry in maybe the last 7-8 years. I don't think we've gotten all the small ones. Here's a bunch of specific ones. These are not well known, I guess. And they're sort of dull. The reason they're dull is that the values are very special. What I was really interested in was, can you find an example of a dihedral group with arbitrarily many prime factors as a CI group? And if you pick the values correctly, you can construct, you can prove such a thing. So I probably don't want to do any more of that. So there's the list as far as I know. Like I said, it's mainly here for reference, and so that you have the citations and if you're interested in looking at them. All right. So let me talk about a different result, and this is personally, I guess this is more along the lines of what I'm interested in now, and this is the isomorphism problem for all combinatorial objects. Misha mentioned this result a couple days ago. We proved a special case of this earlier today in the case of ZQP. So here's the result of Palfay. G is a CI group if and only if its order is 4, or the GCD of N and P of N is 1, or P is Euler's phi function. Before I go on to the next result,
I was just checking to see if there was a comment there. Y'all know what's special about these numbers, GCD and phi of n equals 1. These are the groups for which, these are the values of n for which every group of order n is cyclic. So, and that's actually not a coincidence. You might think that's the end of the story, but no, it isn't. Here's the result of Mises that I like very much. So this is from 99. Let's take m is p1 through pr. Each of these p sub i's is prime, and the product of those primes has the nice GCD condition. So we're stepping back from Pauli's theorem, but only by not introducing additional primes, but letting the primes lead to higher powers. The conclusion is the isomorphism problem for cyclic combinatorial objects reduces to that of, there's a typo there, this should be z mod p sub I to the a sub I for cyclic groups. Okay, so now this in some sense doesn't solve the isomorphism problem, it reduces it to a smaller problem, which is obviously a good thing. Here's another, this is a result of mine. Together, it's a combination of two of the results, one of mine and one of Mises. And it hasn't, it's not in the literature, but it really just follows from a result in there and a result in there. But if you take just a bunch of positive integers that satisfy this GCD condition, so the GCD of n sub I and n sub j times phi of n sub j is 1. If you take n to be the product of all of those, then the same thing happens. The isomorphism problem for circular combinatorial objects reduces to that of the cyclic groups. So here you actually get some more primes, but you still have to have the appropriate conditions. One more result along these lines, and this one is a bit weaker. Let me state the result, and then I'll sort of talk about what. Obviously, it's not finished. There's a condition here. So this is actually, in some sense, stronger because the groups are going to be more general, but it's going to be weaker because another condition has to be satisfied, and I'll tell you about that at the end. But notice that still we have this m is p1 through pr, where m satisfies this GCD condition. And again, I'm not letting the primes change, I'm just letting the powers change. But this time, instead of having a cyclic group, you just have a nilpotent group of that order. The conclusion is the same, that the isomorphism problem reduces to the Celo subgroups. And before we have to see those subgroups, but now there's a condition. That whenever delta is an SG, there exists a phi. Oh, that should these should be deltas, sorry. And they're deltas that, oh gosh, that's bad. I didn't read that too carefully. There's our conjugate. You can conjugate the conjugate and get something that's called M-stepping primitive. Now we've actually seen an M-stepping primitive group. P group, transitive P groups for M step and primitive. What does it mean? It basically means that you can find blocks of prime size, and then you can find blocks of product of two primes that contain the blocks of prime size, that you can find blocks of three primes that contain the blocks of size two primes, that contain the blocks of size primes, all the way up. And if you think about our proofs for ZP cubed, for ZP squared, all of these, what we did first was we found blocks. And once we found the blocks, then we could use different techniques to conjugate away, continue the conjugation. And basically here, I was not able to find the blocks, but I was able to, if you gave me the blocks, I could finish the problem from there. So here's a problem that I eventually, not very smart, but eventually I realized I was working on this problem. Let's let h1 through hr be groups and g be the direct product. determine necessary and sufficient conditions for the Cayley isomorphism problem of G in every class of combinatorial objects to induce the Cayley isomorphism problem for Cayley objects of the smaller groups. And all of these theorems are sort of partial solutions to that. I have other examples as well, but none of this is published because I can't really figure out what the condition is. This may seem like a little bit of a stretch of a problem, but this is one thing Nisha mentioned. There's sort of a full floor conjecture. Maybe somebody actually first did that, that if H and G are CI groups with respect to digraphs of relatively prime order, then G cross H is a CI group with respect to digraphs. This problem 74 is really, in some sense, taking the full floor graph conjecture and putting the context of all. So that's a problem I very much like. And you may think, who cares? And the answer is, well, I do, for that reason. I also care for another reason. The Cayley isomorphism problem isn't the only problem that I work on with vertex transitive graphs. One of the other problems I like to do is to classify vertex transitive graphs in terms of their minimal transitive subgroups. And if you're thinking about the Cayley graph construction, this is why I would do this. So for example, I would like to know, if you give me a graph, is it a Cayley graph? If it is a Cayley graph, I would like to know all the groups on which it's a Cayley graph. If it's not a Cayley graph, I would like to find a minimal transitive subgroup that would play the role of GL, i.e. you give me a vertex, you give me the neighbors, you give me this minimal transitive subgroup, and then I can construct the whole graph. So this is just a sort of a nice way of thinking about constructing all graphs, and then maybe you'd use the isomorphism problem to whittle down duplications, things like that. And I have found this most abstract form of the Cayley isomorphism problem to be quite useful. And the reason it's useful is, we've seen in primitive groups. Yeah, we know if we have a block system, then we can think of it as being SM with SK, if you will. And if you have the automorphism group of a graph that's in primitive, and you think of it as being in a minimal wreath product, yeah, so choose the two groups to be as small as possible. Yeah? Those two groups do not have to be automorphism groups of graphs and digraphs, which means that if you have an primitive group, the obvious thing to do is to try to go by induction, reduce it to the smaller graphs, away you go. And the problem is that doesn't work, because the smaller graphs, the smaller groups that you reduce to, they might not be the groups that you found in the steps before induction. So in a case like this, what you need is not a graph theoretic result, but you need a group theoretic result. And so here's a theorem from 2000 that I proved. And if you actually go through the proof and you find the crucial bit, we're going to find that it's Hallface theorem. So what does the theorem say? Let n be a positive integer that satisfies the GCD condition. So vertex transitive digraph of order n, it's isomorphic to a circular digraph of order n, if and only if its automorphism group contains a transitive solvable subgroup. Okay, great. What should I say about this? This is actually sort of a nice condition, because solvable means that you avoid the non-abelian simple groups. So that you can't have any primitive groups. Primitive groups are all known. Yeah, y'all see what I'm getting at. And what people do is there's all sorts of classifications of graphs that have primitive automorphism groups, things like that. And this says as long as you can avoid those, you're going to have a circuit. There's the remark that I was looking for earlier, so I'll just skip it. Okay. So, getting to the very, very bitter end now, I'd sort of like to talk about things where more work can be done. When people work on the Cayley isomorphism problem, most people, by and large, want to do is figure out if it's a CI group. And there are many, many people who, if the answer is no, it's not a CI group, they just, they're done. So if you have a group that was not on the list of possible CI groups, those are known not to be CI groups, and very, very little is known about the isomorphism problem. But the basic strategy of solving the Cayley isomorphism problem will work. That was why I had a general strategy for solving the isomorphism problem. It turns out to be pretty much the same. You want to find the conjugates and classes of the regular subgroups, and if you find the full automorphism group, you find those, you can extract a solving set, and away you go. And outside of the cyclic groups, which have been taken care of, there are a few results, but not many at all. So there are lots and lots of problems there, but they're probably not really terribly easy. A lot of them. What if you say, well, okay, I'm not going to insist that I be looking at a Cayley graph. What about non-Cayley graphs? There's lots and lots of non-Cayley graphs. They're very important. Very, very little has been done on those. And I think, for PQ vertices, this problem has been sorted out, but I think other than that, almost nothing is known. And there should be some problems there that are quite difficult if you pick your problem. Something Misha mentioned, what about other classes of combinatorial objects? There really should be some quite doable problems with other classes of combinatorial objects. With a lot of the other classes, quite frankly, the reason very little is known is because nobody's actually bothered to sit down and see what could be done. So I think for some classes of combinatorial objects, even ZPQ or ZP squared has not been sorted out. And I think if I were a student or a young person and I wanted to learn the basic techniques, I would probably start with a different combinatorial object than graphs, simply because with graphs, people have been working on the problem. The things that are left are probably, there's going to be some exceptions, but a lot of the problems that are left are hard, and so maybe not something you want to start with, if that makes sense. Maybe your second problem. All right, here is my last problem. And this is sort of a problem that maybe I'm the only one that's interested in. And this is, I almost put that this was my bucket list. Have you all heard about this bucket list stuff? Yeah, you know. Well, you'd say you're American. Do y'all know what kick the bucket means? It means die. And so in the States, and probably in Britain too, they have what's called a bucket list. And this is your list of things that you want to do before you die. I don't have a very long bucket list. I almost wrote my bucket list because this was number two, and it's the last. The first one is I just don't want to die. But I have a specific age that I want to make it to. It's 72. But nobody cares about that. This problem is my second one. And if you're going to put a math problem on your bucket list, you want to do two things, especially if it's the only problem on your bucket list. You want to make it hard. You want it so it's going to take you some time. Because what? If you finish it, then it's time to kick the bucket. You also want to make it doable, so your life isn't, from your point of view, a complete failure. So this is a problem that is doable,
I would like encyclopedic knowledge of vertex transitive to dry graphs of order product of the most three not necessarily distinct primes. And I'll tell you what I mean by encyclopedic. I'm a symmetry guy. That's what I care about. So for me, I want to know everything there is to know about the symmetries of these vertex transitive digraphs. Now, there is a reason I want this encyclopedic knowledge. And that is because one of the things we discussed, we looked at ZP squared. And if the CELOP subgroup didn't have order P squared, it blew up into a real product and life is good. If you go to P cubed, that doesn't happen. It gets more complicated. And how shall I say? You don't want to get in a situation where you just add primes. Yeah, y'all see what I'm getting at? You don't want to. What's the point in finding all vertex transitive graphs of product of six primes? Well, why is six better than five? I don't know. I don't know. But I do know that when you go from two to three, things get more complicated. Three is definitely a lot more complicated. We can figure out the encyclopedic information. And to me, these are just sort of the basic examples that we need to be able to study to figure out what happens in the more complicated. So what I mean by this is I would like to classify the digraphs in terms of a minimal transitive subgroup of the automorphism group. So this minimal transitive subgroup, I'd like to know this all the time. There is information that's known on this for PQ. Basically, all of these problems have been solved. So PQ is done, but P cubed, it's known that every vertex transitive graph order P cubed is isomorphic to a Cayley graph. So P cubed is done, P squared cubed, a little bit is known for 4P, and special values of PQ and R related to this Euler phi function. But in general, we don't know. I'd like to solve the isomorphism problem for each minimal transitive subgroup. Again, done for PQ, for product of three primes. The isomorphism problem has been solved for Cayley graphs of ZP cross ZP squared. Everything else is open except for the thing, the Cayley graphs that I've already told you, the CI groups and the SIP groups. We have seen that one graph can be a Cayley graph on more than one group. Or maybe it's got minimal transitive subgroups that aren't, that are regular and are not regular and are different. I would like to know all of those, and I would like to know how the various classes overlap. We've actually solved this problem for abelian groups, Cayley graphs of abelian groups of order P squared. We basically saw that they're CI or they're a Reith product, two circulants of prime order. And to me, that's a perfect solution. And I'd like to know all the automorphisms. Full automorphisms. Anyway, I thought I would pose this problem sort of formally so that if you decided to work on it, you'd have something, you know, you can say, hey, he asked the problem. It'll make life easier. Anyway, I'm sorry to end, but that's the... Oh, it's not quite the end. Not quite. There was a survey paper written not too long ago about this. Misha mentioned the survey as well. It's in the citation, so if you want additional information, that would be the choice to start. And now that is the end. Thank you very much.
So I'd like to thank Ted for his nice, useful, and exciting course in Cayley graphs isomorphic problem. So the course was so exciting that one of the plenary speakers, Andrei Vasiliev, decided to change his talk tomorrow, and tomorrow at 4:30 he will be talking about testing isomorphism of central Cayley graphs over almost simple groups in polynomial time. So this is your inspiration, yeah? So the talk will be 2:30. And another thing I would like to tell that today is Ted's birthday. And I'd like to wish Chad to be in good shape, good health, and get new interesting results in kilograms. Thank you.